Hello everyone, welcome back to Hotspur Way for another episode of Inside Spurs, building up to two very big fixtures this weekend, the North London Derby for the women at Tottenham Hotspur Stadium, and then a huge game under the lights away on Friday for the men against Nottingham Forest. Here's what's coming up on the show today. So next up, we turn attention to the City Ground, where a win could put Spurs firmly back in the shake-up at the top. Beth England's with us ahead of the North London Derby for our women's team this weekend. And we'll be hearing from Brennan Johnson with a very special guest. Joining me in the studio today, our club legend, Clive Allen. Clive, good to get back to winning ways against Newcastle, wasn't it?
Absolutely, Ben, yeah. And it was a first-class performance. We scored the goals that our play warranted and, a great result at the end.
Nice atmosphere as well at full-time, wasn't it? You sort of sensed the relief amongst the fans that we were kind of back in that winning mould again.
Yeah, I think the response that they gave was that they enjoyed the performance and obviously they loved the way that certain players, in particular Richarlison, scores his goals, all of a sudden a little bit of relief for everybody. A wonderful, wonderful result.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to talking about Richarlison in a bit, but there was a number of very, very good performances. We're going to do some analysis later on Pap Sarr and Destiny Adogi, who just signed a new contract, and Pedro Porro. But I would love to start, if we can, with the performance of our captain, Sonny. Just tell me how good you think that he's been over the course of the last few weeks, but in particular the other night.
Well, I think moving out onto the left with Richarlison coming in down the middle, he was absolutely sensational against Kieran Trippier, obviously his former teammate, but I just think he was so dynamic when he was in those wide positions. It really was a fabulous performance from him, and the understanding with Destiny was just superb. But time and time again, he was prepared to take on Kieran Trippier and obviously produced a wonderful pass for Destiny's goal. And then again, one-on-one, there's no doubt in his mind he's going to take Kieran on. He gets to the byline again, cuts it back for Richarlison's goal. So it was a massive contribution for Sonny, the captain. And then obviously he won the penalty when he was brought down clean through and stepped up.
Not bad. Absolutely no doubt.
Yeah, and it was a wonderful performance from him.
Fascinating to see. It's our first penalty of the season. I mean, how crazy is that? We're in December, it's our first penalty of the season. But fascinating to see Sonny be the man to go pick up the ball, because I think all of us have been wondering, I wonder who it will be at that point. I guess we know who our penalty taker is.
Yeah, but I thought it was very interesting afterwards saying that he practiced a lot with Harry.
Yep.
He was quite confident and happy to take that penalty kick. Obviously, when Harry was here, he was taking out our penalty kicks, but it looks like Sonny is more than capable.
Right, take me on then to the performance of another forward. You must be delighted for Richarlison.
Absolutely delighted. I think what we saw with him in previous games and for a while since he's been with us, he's been getting in goal scoring positions. But all of a sudden, his work rate was second to none. He's working back tirelessly, interceptions, tackles. And then what I found amazing was that when the ball and the play built up, he was getting into the dangerous positions in the opponent's box. None more so than when he scored his goal. We see Son pick this ball up. And where do you want your centre forward? In the 6-yard box. And look at him. He's looking, he just adjusts his position.
Nice bit of awareness there,
yeah.
Isn't it? Just to drift out.
He adjusts his position just so that Sonny can cut it back to him. He's making challenges in deep areas of the field. But then when we need him central and high, this is brilliant, because it's a wonderful Porro pass. Great touch, good finish.
I loved it. I have to say, Clive, this is the thing that really sort of got me on my feet. I think we can see that Richarlison's moving a lot more freely since he's had that surgery. But seeing him have that desire and that work rate, it really gets the crowd going, doesn't it?
Well, it obviously was hindering him. The injury that he had, the surgery that's taken place, he just looks to be moving much more freely, and he's getting around the field. He's a fantastic athlete, a wonderful footballer, but a fantastic athlete, and he's moving so well now, which is great to see.
Nottingham Forest up next, and while we're on Richarlison, I just want to do a little bit of a throwback here, take you back to last season. I don't know if people remember this. A couple of keepy uppies, which it got a lot of people talking. Do you remember who the man was that gave him a good kick in there?
Well, I would have taken a dislike to that, but look who it is. It's Brendan Johnson, our very own Brendan Johnson, was just making Richarlison aware You can't really do that in the Premier League and get away with it.
Yeah, now very good friends, of course. Let's have a look at the sort of form guide for Nottingham Forest, because it doesn't make for great reading for Forest fans at the moment.
No, they're having a tough time, and they've been beaten heavily at Fulham with the 5 goals. They lost at home to Everton and Brighton. So all of a sudden, on their travels back to London, you know, they've been beaten by West Ham. And then one victory, and only 3 victories in all competitions this season. That is worrying for Steve Cooper, the manager, and Nottingham Forest.
Yeah, in terms of what's been happening recently, I think one that jumps out at me when you're looking at teams struggling in and around you, huge win for Everton there, and that won't help in terms of just starting to spread that feeling of a little bit of worry about relegation when you're playing games at home.
Absolutely, you've got to. When you're down in the lower regions, you've got to make sure, especially against teams that are around you, that you don't get beat. So that Everton result looks very damaging.
Worth noting though as well, of course, that win against Aston Villa. They can turn teams over, we've seen them have a good win against Chelsea as well. So on their day, something to watch out for.
Oh, there's no doubt that they are dangerous at home at the City Ground. There's no doubt about that, and it won't be an easy task. But it's one, I think, with the confidence gained from the Newcastle result, we can take into the game on Friday evening.
Yeah, I mean, we saw it last season. It wasn't an easy game by any stretch. We're going to come back to that a little bit later on. But for now, let's turn attention to our women's team, who have a huge game coming up this Saturday.
The North London Derby. The big one. Bragging rights. Red v white. The sound. The passion. And the roar. Our stadium. Our home. Just 3 points. Break records. Make history. To dare is to do. We want to be in that number. We will be there. Will you?
So, one more reminder, it's not too late. You can still get your tickets. That's tottenhamhotspur.com/WSL and come down to support the women this weekend in a huge game against Arsenal. And I'm delighted to say we're joined by our skipper, Beth England. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
This is your first cap on the show, isn't it?
We should be
handing over a cap,
shouldn't
we?
I'm excited to be here.
How are you? How are you getting on? Is it good to be back in with the group?
Yeah, no, it's really nice. Definitely good to be out on the grass with the team. Feeling more like myself again, so that's really nice.
How long was it that you were up for in total?
Rehab, recovery, since my last game from the World Cup, it'd be 4 months.
That's a long time, isn't it? Yeah. Did you ever have one that long?
I had a year here, so I know what Beth's going through. But I came back to have my best season, so hopefully...
There you go.
Yeah, okay.
That's what it is.
I'll throw that down for you. But yeah, I know how tough it is. You know, they're lonely days when you're on your own, doing your work, trying to get back. I always felt that I came back better, stronger physically, and maybe tougher mentally as well. So,
how did you find it?
I would definitely agree with that. I think like the physical side of it, obviously being able to strengthen other areas that you don't necessarily get the time to work on. Like rehab really makes you work on other areas, and I definitely feel stronger from it. Mentally, there's been some tough days, obviously good days as well, and I think you just have to find it within yourself to build up that resilience to go again. And like, I know some people have longer injuries, like I'm quite lucky that mine was a short-ish period, but for me it felt like a lifetime. I think anyone missing any game, you just want to be back out there. So for me, I'm just glad to be back playing again.
I suppose that's particularly true when you're captain as well, because you want to be you want to be out there leading, right? You want to be in and amongst it.
Yeah, and I think for me it's been a different role this year starting, because obviously, I've just been announced captain and then to be injured, so I've having to learn how to lead from the sidelines, which has probably given me different attributes to being a leader, but I'm looking forward to now being able to use my voice on the pitch, not just off it.
I was just going to say, I'll tell you what it will be. It'll be a lot more fun when you come back, in respect of you're just going to enjoy playing again so much. I'm sure of that.
Yeah, everyone will be sick of my voice, maybe, I'm sure, but yeah.
I was trying to think, I was going through the people that you would have played in the same side that would have been captain for you. I was thinking, who would you say your sort of captaincy style will be most like? Who do you think you sort of gravitate towards the most?
Most like? Oh, I don't know about, if I could be anywhere near a captain like Maren Mjelde, I've done a good job because I feel like she leads very well. Obviously, I wouldn't say I'm like Katie Chapman, where she was more of aggressive, like go, go, go kind of girl. Obviously, we've got Steph and Leah. I feel like we all bring our own different personalities to it. I don't think I could be, I think I'm probably more unique in my own way. But I would say if I can be, I'd like to be like Maren. She was a very cool, calm leader. Although I'm not much of a calm person, I think I'm quite rational in my decision making. So I'd hope that that's what I can bring.
So it's been nearly a year now. Mm-hmm. I think we're coming up just
coming
sort of
up just short of a year,
2-3 weeks. Have you found it? Have you settled?
It's been a whirlwind, I must say. Kind of just got thrown straight in the deep end when I came. Obviously, it was a tough ride last season. Relegation battle, something that I've never experienced before. Hopefully, never experience again. But I think you learn a lot about yourself when you. Well, especially I did. I think coming from a team of, to put it as bluntly, as winners, like consistently winning year after year, to a team where you've actually got to dig deep and find new ways of helping your peers, the staff and the team to win games, can say a lot about a person. And look, I was very miserable to a point with football before I came here because I wasn't getting the game time, I wasn't as happy on the pitch, and albeit the results weren't going our way at times, I still was able to feel happier in the sense that I was back playing, I was doing everything I could, I was scoring goals, I was helping the team. And I think sometimes you just have to accept that the happiness element can overweigh the trophy side of things. And hopefully we can get both the happiness and the trophies here. That's my aim. I want to push this football club, but I do think for self-importance that happiness has to be the core, because if you don't enjoy your job, you don't perform at your best.
But I think you can see that of you, Beth. I think you can see when you're on the pitch, you're just, you can tell you're just totally in it. You know, it feels like, for you, it must have felt like I'm wasting a gift that I've got, like not putting this to use, you know, not being out there on the pitch.
To an extent, yeah, I think you can't speak to any professional footballer and say they're happy to be on a bench. No one's gonna want that. And for me, I just wanted to play. I know I can score goals. I know what I bring to a team, and I think it was time that I was let loose of that. And luckily, say Spurs brought me in, I did my best for them, I helped them, and we're in a much better place because of it.
I have to say I can relate to that, because obviously changing clubs, especially when you're a goal scorer and you're not playing, the biggest incentive is just being given that opportunity, that little bit of love, that the team you're going to want you to perform. And obviously you had a long time at Chelsea before arriving here. Mm-hmm. So you've now experienced that new challenge, which I think sometimes just rejuvenates you, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely. And I think as much as, like, look, I can't speak highly enough of Chelsea. I loved my time there, but I knew it was time to move on. And coming into an environment where straight away I felt the love, I felt the respect, I felt the trust that they put on me. From all the staff, obviously Rhiann was the one that brought me in, and like I say, straight away it wasn't about, okay, you have to come in, you have to score all goals, like you have to do this. It was, do you know what, we know what you can bring, just adjust, because it was a big adjustment moving and stuff. So it was kind of like find your feet and then we're going. Luckily for me, scored on the first game and it just kind of set the tone for me then. But a lot of that come from the trust and the confidence and the belief that everyone around put in me, and I do think I'm a confidence player, and I've learned over time to dig myself out of holes that when I was younger I probably was, again, not as resilient enough, not mentally tough enough to deal with in certain situations. But I definitely think the homeliness of, like, the trust and the belief and the confidence massively impacted the way I was able to perform for the team last year.
Yeah, some massive goals last year, not least of which at Tottenham Hotspur Stadium, where we'll be this weekend. Very exciting stuff. Talk us through what it means to the team to be playing in that stadium, but also for what is, just for this club, the biggest game of the calendar?
Yeah, North London Derby, you kind of don't get much bigger than that, do you? Especially at the Tottenham Stadium. It's a beautiful stadium. I've been there playing on the field and been watching as a fan in the stand, and I must say it is a delight. But I think I'm just excited for the team, and the girls I know are raring to go. I think we had a really good result last night and how we performed, and hopefully there's going to be a lot of noise, a lot of fans bouncing on Saturday ready to support us, because they don't get much bigger than that, and I think it's going to be a nice, feisty rivalry game.
Yeah, talk us through the game in the Conti Cup. A really, really good performance there.
Yeah, the girls did amazing. I was so proud of them. Obviously, coming off the back of two really tough defeats, I think it was important that we showed a bit of grit and a bit of fight. I think we definitely brought the aggressive element, like, again, numbers in the box, Martha doing a great job, as we know she does. I thought Jess Naz was so impressive last night, and it's nice to finally see her confidence grow and get those goals that she's been searching for in the last few games. And even the likes of, like, you've got Kit Graham stepping in a position she don't usually play, Asmita, Rhea playing in different positions, and everyone just knew their role last night. They did their job, they fought for the team, and they made good decisions. And I think that's probably what we've lacked in the last few games, is when we are regaining the ball, decision making and making the right pass and even just retaining the ball a bit longer. So it was definitely a positive step forward in the way as Tottenham we want to play. We want to still continue to be brave. We don't just want to go into the shelling it long kind of ball. Sometimes you have to, that it does work at times, but I really love the way that this team is growing, and even though the results haven't all been amazing, we're still finding ways to improve week on week.
Are you enjoying this style of football? Does this work for you personally in terms of seeing how Robert wants the side to play?
Yeah, I think it's just nice that we have a style. I think when I first came last year, like I say, it was a bit of a mess really. There wasn't really an identity. And what I love about Robert, what he's brought in, is that he wants a specific style of play. Whether we all agree with it or not, which obviously most of us do, but I think it's just continuing to build on it and trust that we are good footballers and live on the ball, enjoy the ball and play freely. And I think you can see that that resonates in the men's game as well. And we're definitely having more possession compared to last year. And I feel like last year all I did was run. I barely touched the ball. So for me this year, seeing how much possession we've got, the style of play that we're doing, the different kind of movements, and seeing other characters from the team as well, even from last year and the new ones, growing into this style of play and football, it's been really entertaining to watch.
Yeah, there's a lovely crossover there with the men's team as well, because Ange said to us many times, it's a non-negotiable as a player that you're going to run. But wouldn't you rather be doing your running
with the
when you've got the ball, when you're in the attacking third, as opposed to going the other way?
Exactly, do you know what I mean? We didn't pick athletics for a reason. We want to kick a ball, so it's part of the game, but you just got to make sure that you're enjoying yourself on the ball, but again, being calm in your decision making. And I think the two games previous, we probably didn't do a good enough job of that, but to last night, sorry, we definitely showed that.
Can I get you to talk us through our upcoming WSL fixtures? So thankfully, you've got a bit of a breather. Now you've got a bit of time to just rest up. And I mean, although I'm sure you're itching to go, let's just have a look at those fixtures then that are coming up. What's jumping out at you here?
Obviously, North London Derby first, but West Ham will be interesting, first game of the season into the 2024 year. Obviously, Rianne is now there, so that'll be an interesting matchup. They're all exciting. I don't think you can particularly point out a specific one. They're all going to be tough games. We've seen in this league how teams are really stepping it up this year, and big teams are losing points. Like Brighton took points off City. Arsenal beat the champions the other day, so obviously the Spurs City one probably is jumping out a bit more because you want to undo the damage that was done previously. But I think they're all going to be exciting, and I'm excited for us to start in the new year to kick off and start a second part of the campaign.
Just finally, before we let you go, let's just have a quick look at the table as well, because this must make for nicer reading for you now in comparison to when you were talking about being in a relegation battle.
It is, yeah. Look, the season is a marathon, it's not a sprint. It's nice that even off the back of some bad results, we're still sitting mid-table. Obviously, we want to be as high as possible, and I think anything as it stands right now is an improvement from last year, and I'm more than sure that we're going to be able to continue to push on, climb up that board, get more points in there. It's just exciting, I think, for any neutral or any fan, the games that are coming around, because not every game is as black and white as it seems, and like I say, big teams can drop points and it can also get tight quickly at the bottom, so it's definitely going to be entertaining.
Tell me what the next couple of weeks looks like for you. What does Christmas look like in the England household?
Oh, not that much fun for me at the minute. I'm going to be based in London. My family are going to come down and spend it with me and just be there with my dog. Just having a nice little bit of a break, but not too big of a break, because I'm conscious for myself, I want to get back at it, so I'll have to keep ticking over as the Christmas break comes.
Can't wait to watch you this weekend, yeah. And also in the new year. We're buzzing to see you back out there scoring, yeah, tons of goals for us. So thank you so much for joining us, Beth. Absolute pleasure to have you. And now we're going to turn attention over to the men's side and some very, very good news for Destiny Adogi.
Son, running a trip here, still Son, electric play, brilliant goal! Destiny Adogi!
I'm happy because I think to be here in this club is a big dream for me, so I'm really happy for this opportunity, and it's a pleasure. From the first day I came in, I feel at home with the players, the coach staff and the club. I feel so welcome and I'm happy to be here. I think the way the club brings you in, the way the club respect you, show you love, the players, everyone. So from the first day, I was just with one objective, to play good, to show my best, to help the team. I'm happy for how it's going, and obviously we can do more, and we keep working to do more. I think it's something different for me, because it was a different role, but I'm trying to learn as much as I can every day in the training with the coach staff, the team, and I think every day is getting better, and I'm really happy of this position, and I'm trying to do my best. It's a big journey, and we have to stay focused, keep working hard, and every day together, keep working at the games, bringing the result, and I think we're building something big, and we have to just keep going together. The league is really tough. It's a physical league, it's high intensity, so you have to be ready. And I think the staff is doing a big work, because every day we work hard, and it's showing in the pitch. Every day I'm learning something new, playing with great players, and it's just a benefit. I think it's gonna be a good season. It's a long season to go, so we have to just keep working, stay focused, and I have to stay focused, and every day I'll try to do my best. Me, my family, everyone is happy.
Fantastic news for all of us here at Tottenham Hotspur, that Destiny's going to be here for a long, long time. What a brilliant player, Clive, and what a phenomenal start he's had to life here in N17.
Absolutely incredible in the way that he's just seamlessly fitted into the team, but his style of play as well has just been phenomenal, from that left-back position, getting forward, obviously dovetailing with whoever's playing outside him. It's a massive signing for us for a long time to come.
Right, I've been looking forward to analysis time all week since we had that result against Newcastle, Clive. So we're going to feature Destiny Adogi, we're going to talk through Pedro Porro, and then we're going to go on and talk about Pap Sarr in a bit. Let's start with Destiny Adogi and Pedro Porro. They've been phenomenal, but they're doing some really, really interesting stuff in advanced areas at the moment.
Well, I think the biggest question is, are they fullbacks? Because the positions they're playing, it's extraordinary at times how far forward they are. Look at Destiny here. You would say that's a left winger retrieving the ball, winning the ball back, and then ended up in the opponent's penalty box. Again, he's over the halfway line. At the top of your screen is Pedro Porro as well, but he's our furthest forward player, our left back, as our furthest forward player. And at times, he gets forward, he creates a chance. Obviously, Romero scores that goal. But Porro on the other side is also very high. He's getting himself forward. Destiny's on the ball. Look at Pedro joining him on the same level as an advanced midfield player. We've got our midfield players actually behind our two fullbacks, and that is causing so many problems. We're overloading that midfield area.
So this is really impressive the other night. This is Destiny's first goal for the club. He plays the pass, but how impressed are you with his position here?
Well, he's given license to go forward. He's not afraid, and he's brave to go into the opponent's box. Porro played the ball square to him. It was fed wide to Sonny, and he keeps going. He's not restricted. He keeps running, and he ends up in the penalty box, unmarked, to score his first goal for the club.
So we've spoken about them being in these advanced areas that are often narrow, but they also give us width as well. We've seen them pop up with assists starting in wide areas.
Yeah, and that is always the understanding with the wide players. On this occasion, Destiny picks the ball up very high but wide, but then he works the ball inside, 1-2 with Son, and as he cuts the ball back, it's Kulusevski arrives from the opposite side of the field. So he's really, in effect, playing as a wide left winger on that occasion, as was Porro against Liverpool late in the game, a fierce cross into the six-yard box, but he's given us the width. We had to go round the side of Liverpool the way that they were defending. So what they're understanding is, yes, they can go infield to make the numbers up in that midfield area, but if we do have possession of the ball, they can also give us width wide from the touch lines as well.
We've seen Destiny pop up with a goal, but we've also seen a phenomenal dimension to Pedro Porro's play this season in terms of his range of passing. Got a glimpse of it against Newcastle, but that's not the first time that we've seen him pop up with a great assist.
No, that's right. And I think what it is, we see that he has a license when he takes that first touch to play the ball forward. And on this occasion, he picks Richarlison out for his second goal against Newcastle. A wonderful diagonal pass, and then great appreciation from the manager who's just near him on the touchline. This was a brilliant ball for Son against Burnley, brilliantly taken. But it's a magnificent ball in behind the defence because he's looking forward. His first thought and his first look is forward and to play that ball, and he can execute the pass.
Yeah, wonderful range of passing, wonderful technique. And we also saw him getting into that central area and create that the penalty for Sonny as well the other night, which was fantastic to see. Now, the reason why we wanted to pick up Destiny and Pedro here, not just because of the work that they're doing going forward, but what it means for the rest of the team. Now, Pap Sarr, another brilliant display against Newcastle. Why does he link to what Pedro Porro is doing?
Well, he has to almost cover, and what I'm saying cover, he has to cover the positions that they vacate. And look at him here, making up ground. He's ending up in a right-back position, making the tackle on Gordon against Newcastle. Pedro has got back, but at times, because they're so advanced, both full-backs, Pap has to do a lot of work, and his physical endeavours are incredible. The amount of ground he covers at times is superb. And then, even though he has all that effort, he has the ability to keep the ball, to make sure that we don't turn over possession. Wonderful play here, and all of a sudden, we're out. Porro sets it to him, but again, that instinctive look forward first is so important.
His reading of the game is really impressive as well, Clive. This is against Luton, just making a really smart interception, but we've also seen him a couple of times, particularly in the game against United, just read the danger.
Well, he's sensing the danger, and what he's sensing is the positional places that other players, his teammates, are in. And you can see here, both Pap and Kulusevski making great strides to get back into the area that Pedro Porro's vacated. So his athleticism has been phenomenal, his play with the ball has been fantastic, and we certainly missed him when he was out for those few games.
Should we just have a look at his heat map and his touch map from the game against Newcastle? Because I think it really just shows that point that you're making there about Pedro Porro being in advanced areas and then Pap doing his work to cover him.
Well, we see it here, the lots of touches he makes in that sort of right back position, you would describe it, where Porro's higher up the field. But then when we are in possession of the ball, he's high on the right hand side, and you see where the red areas are, where he gets his most touches in the game, which is fantastic to see. So what we've got is a midfield player that literally covers every blade of grass on the field, but certainly he gives our right side of our team really great strength in the way he performs.
Look, and we're aware of his wonderful athletic attributes, but I think what this shows is there's a phenomenal game intelligence and game awareness that perhaps is a little bit underappreciated.
Yeah, that's right. And that is having a really strong mindset, understanding the role that he plays. He's doing it perfectly at the moment. He really is.
Yeah, listen, we're going to be seeing a lot more of Pap Sarr, I'm sure, over the course of the season, doing an incredible job. And we really, really missed him when he was out injured.
And you know what I love most of all? He plays with a smile on his face. He's actually enjoying everything that he's doing for the team.
Yeah, 100%. Look, we're going to come back to talk a little bit more about the game against Forest. But first, it's time to hear from the boss, Ange. And then we're going to hear from two men who know a thing or two about this fixture. That's Brennan Johnson and Michael Dawson.
Okay, Angie with us, looking ahead to Forest City Ground on Friday night. I mean, first of all, looking at team news.
We've still got quite a significant absence. We've got eight on the injured table. Unfortunately, Gio Van Celso will join them. He'll miss this week. Hopefully nothing too bad. But, yeah, we're kind of, in terms of the guys from last week, we're one more down. But the rest of the guys are OK.
What's Gio done?
Just a slight injury training. We're still trying to work it out. Nothing serious.
Can I just ask you how Madders and Mickey are getting on?
Yeah, they're going okay. They're obviously going through their rehab with Bentancur and Solomon and Phillips and all these other guys. So they're cracking on with it, but still a fair way away.
Can I ask you about Destiny? New contract this week. He's been fantastic.
Yeah, he has. Yeah, he's you know, young guy. Obviously, his first year in the Premier League, and you know, he's really come in with a real positive attitude, and he works hard at training, and he kind of. He understands, you know, he's still got a lot to learn, but within that context, he's still able to make impact in the league straight away. And longer term, I think it's important with these guys that, you know, we kind of try and keep the core of this group together for the coming years, and pleased for him and his family.
I mean, that's what people forget, how young these guys are.
Yeah, that's right, you know, him and sort of Pape and, you know, even guys like Mickey and Pedro, Decky, all of them, you know, and Brennan, you know. That's what we're trying to build, and you know, we're kind of in the first phase of it. So having guys like Destiny sort of commit to us shows us that they feel like they're in the right place.
I'll just ask you about Forest. I mean, a bit of a tough run at the moment, but I mean, we know they're dangerous at the City Ground. What are you expecting on Friday?
Yeah, as you said, home, they're a different proposition irrespective of their form. It's a hard place to go. You know, the fans get behind them. It's you know, they do well on their home ground, so it'll be a tough test for us, obviously. You know, they're going through a rough trot, but at the same time, they have quality within their team to cause anyone problems. So, a good test for us. You know, we've done pretty well away from home in terms of countering these kind of games and the atmospheres we're going to face, and it'll be another challenge tomorrow.
Hi, everyone. Here we are with me, Michael Dawson. Got a guest that I know better than most people do. Brennan, how are you?
Good, thank you, mate. Yourself?
Very well, thank you.
Good.
Excited about going back to City Ground?
Yeah, really excited. I think it's one that you check when you first sign. I think, obviously, the game against Arsenal. But after that, I was looking forward to coming back to the City Ground. And yeah, playing here again, I think it's been unbelievable since I've been here. And, yeah, hopefully we can go there and have a good performance.
I've got a question, not for you, I've got for all these watchers, that no one knows. You know this, Brennan. I shared a dressing room with your dad. I cleaned your dad's boots. Mm-hmm. I played with him. We got to a playoff semi-final.
Yeah.
And then end up playing with you. Is there any other players out there that can say they did that? Anyway, John, it was great to share a dressing room with your dad, great to share a dressing room with you. How hard was it to leave the club that you grew up supporting, grew up watching, playing for, getting them to the Premier League, keeping them in the Premier League, and then you made the big move down south?
Yeah, it was a really difficult situation. Decision to make, I think. Obviously, I was there pretty much all my life. It really was like home there, going into training ground and being with the lads, seeing so many faces that I know and making such good relationships. But I think this season probably was the right time for me to kind of make the move, and coming here has been unbelievable so far, and I'm very happy with the move I made, and I can't wait to keep going here.
How different has been your expectation at this football club compared to Forest? Theirs was probably survival last year. Here you're looking at the top end of the table. How hard has that been to deal with the pressures?
Yeah, as you said, it's just different situations. I think mentally at Forest, it's when I was there last season, it was mostly about results, because obviously we didn't make the best start, so we were almost playing catch up. But then we got to a really good point where we were able to say that we could stay up, and we were definitely in the mix. And I think, yeah, it's more week by week at Forest, trying to just get 3 points. Obviously, you want to keep performing well, but here it's all about how you're performing, the manager's style of play, and trying to really replicate that on a match day. So I think in terms of your mindset, it's different. I think here's a lot about performance and things like that, whereas Forest is more 3 points. But yeah, I've been really happy to make the decision to come here, and yeah, I'm really liking it.
I think every Spurs fan will agree your performances and the team's performances have been magnificent this season. Let's touch on some of the players that have really helped you settle in. You talk about the captain of Son, James Maddison. Anyone else that's really helped you settle in?
Yeah, I think just because there's a lot of players here, like similar age group as me, and also there's players that have come in this season as well. So I think having players that have come through the door maybe a few weeks before and are getting more used to it, it definitely helps, because they're kind of in the same boat as you, and having lads at the same age, it makes you feel more welcome, more at ease. I think a lot of the lads, a lot of the young lads, there's some senior players as well, but everyone's, it's a really easy dressing room here. I think you can see that on a match day and how we perform together. So I couldn't really have asked for much more, to be honest.
How's the gaffer been?
Yeah, the gaffer's been really good with me. I think, of course, a lot of fans know him as from his interviews and things like that. But with us, he's very, he's a bit more serious. I think he doesn't do too much talking in the week. He kind of saves it for the day before the game. And on the day of the game, he's really motivational. I think his speaking's unbelievable. And with me as well, I think he lets me know when there's certain things that he doesn't like and there's things that he does like. So I think for me, it's always about developing and trying to listen to every single word that he says and continue growing as a player.
Well, he certainly made it clear you were the number one target that he wanted. He worked so hard to make that happen. How much do you want to show that faith by showing your performances and bringing goals? You got your goal against Wolves. Mm-hmm. You had a couple against Newcastle that hit the post. I've seen you score goals. Tell these Spurs fans that there's plenty more to come.
Yeah, that's the plan, I think, for me. Getting settled in, I feel settled now and I feel like really a part of the team. So for now, now it's just about kicking on and getting into the positions, because in the way that we play, I think if I always get in the position that I can be and attacking the back post and getting in positions to score, I think the goals will come and the team's goals will come. I think, as you said, there's not just three players in the team that are going to score. As we showed against Newcastle, I think all the lads can score. The lads get in different positions that even I'm not used to seeing Destiny get across the six-yard post. It's something new for me, but it's a joy to play in every week.
It's certainly a joy to watch. Yeah. Where do you see your best position?
I think still not set in stone one position. I think off either wing at the minute. I've been enjoying different types of games. I think against City, I really enjoyed the left. And then the other night, I really enjoyed playing on the right. So I think having the option of playing on both. But I think in this team, they both come with different responsibilities. So I'm kind of trying to pick up important bits to play on either side.
Jono, enjoy your trip back to the City Ground.
Thank you very much.
I wish you luck. Keep up the good work, mate.
Cheers, mate.
It is a first Premier League visit to the City Ground for Tottenham Hotspur in more than 23 years. Kulusevski. Kane is making a run out to his right-hand side, and here is Kane. Kane shoots. Oh, and Kane's found the net. Henderson flat-footed. Such a precise finish, and Spurs, with their first attack on 5 minutes, have found a way through in Nottingham. Takes on Williams, digs out the cross. Oh, and Kane was there. Oh, there's an appeal for handball. He's claiming he was fouled here, Cook, but it looked extremely suspicious in real time. That is a penalty all day long. He'll say it's a foul. Kane has already beaten Dean Henderson today. Can he get his second from the penalty spot? What a save by Henderson. Kane is kept out. Richarlison. Kane, 2-0. With 10 minutes to go, that might seal it. Richarlison's first assist for Tottenham Hotspur. And Kane does get his second after the penalty miss. 9th minute of added time. That's it. Spurs win. It is their best start to a season in 13 years. A tough win, but they get it. Full time, Nottingham Forest 0, Spurs 2.
Fingers crossed for another result like that on Friday night at the City Ground. Just time now to look at the fixtures that are coming up in the Premier League this week. Some really, really important fixtures coming up here, not just our game on Friday, but also for what this means in the shake-up at the top of the Premier League, Clive.
Yeah, and it just seems every week we're saying how important the fixtures are, and there's certainly some difficult ones, you would have to say, for the teams around us, and that's where we have to focus. I think Villa's trip to Brentford on Sunday is a really tricky game. Liverpool playing Manchester United. In a way, you hope Manchester United can take some points off of Liverpool and we can just get ourselves back into that top four, back in contention, which I think we're more than capable of.
Well, I mean, we've got Liverpool-Arsenal coming up over the next week or so as well to look forward to. And I think, as always, obviously, it doesn't matter when you get your 3 points. 3 points are still 3 points. But to do it on Friday night and then have the rest of the weekend to just see how that pressure affects the teams that are around us is quite crucial.
Absolutely, Ben, because 3 points on Friday night, everybody else is playing catch-up. They can do no more than catch us up, because if we're plus 3 points from Friday night, they've got to win just to stay in the same place.
Well, let's see what that will look like then in terms of the table, what it would do for us to pick up 3 points on Friday night. We know that we're close, but really, a win is what we need in order to make sure that we're in that shake-up again.
Yeah, just closing that gap to City and closing the gap to the top four. 3 points, 33 points, we'll be in amongst the top four places, and that is going to be vital. And that's why it's a massive opportunity if we can win on Friday evening.
Yeah, and then it just allows you to look ahead a little bit. If you get that win on Friday and you think, right, you go to 33 points, you know we've got a huge home game against Everton coming up as well. And a fairly kind festive schedule in comparison to some other teams in terms of the home games that we've got, because we played so many away games at the beginning of the season. But it does put us in a very strong position.
It does, but the most important thing was the Newcastle victory, getting back to winning ways, having that confidence going into this period of games. It's going to come fast and furious, those games, an FA Cup tie to look forward to at home at the beginning of January as well. So it's all looking very positive.
Tell me, Clive, how's it going to play out?
I can see us in the new year being in the top four and consolidating our position now. I think it's going to be a very important festive period, but one in which I think we can make great progress.
Thank you so much, Clive. I'm going to assume that you're going for a Spurs win on Friday night. You can see us
Absolutely.
Winning comfortably there.
Absolutely, yes.
Love it. Yeah. And look, I look forward to watching that one with you. And thank you so much for watching along at home. Just a quick reminder, we will have after that game the review show for you to look forward to. And then from midnight onwards, you can watch the full 90 back again. I did this the other night, actually. I do this after every game now, Clive. I watch it on sort of 2 or 3 times speed so I can pick out all of our analysis clips for the next week. So if you sound like me, you can watch the whole 90 back again from 12:01. So make sure you look out for that. Just remains to say, good luck to the girls on Saturday. Huge game in that North London derby. Make sure you grab hold of a ticket if you can and get down to support them. And good luck to the guys on Friday night. Fingers crossed, another big 3 points for the men there at the City Ground as well. Enjoy your weekend. Come on, you Spurs.